This is, this has got to be like right in front of your lips. So if you're this tall, you got to have it like that. If you're this tall, you got to have it like that, okay? Just make sure to point it at yourself.
All right.
Can you remember that?
Yeah.
Make sure to still stand in front of, make sure to still stand in front of the mic and aim this at yourself, okay? Before you begin. That way,
thank you.
Hello, everyone. We're going to ask everyone to please come in and be seated. And we would also ask that if you still have beverages, if you can go ahead and drink them so that as people are moving about, we don't want to take the chance of them spilling on someone. Okay? If you still have your solid food, take your time with it. It's not going to spill on anyone. Okay? But we are getting ready to start. We definitely want to be starting on time so that we have probably about close to 100 students here who are going to be performing, and we want to make sure that we get them out and at home at a decent time, okay? The program will not go any longer than 7 o'clock. Okay, so I'm going to turn this over to Ms. Strong as people are still coming in, and she'll take you through the program.
Frederick Douglass stood at the podium, trembling with nervousness. Before him sat abolitionists who had traveled to the Massachusetts island of Nantucket. Only 23 years old at the time, Douglass overcame his nervousness and gave a stirring, eloquent speech about his life as an enslaved person. Douglass would continue to give speeches for the rest of his life and would become a leading spokesperson for the abolition of enslavement and for racial equality. Good evening, and welcome to the Oratorical Review. My name is Naresh Strong, and I'm the Director of African and African American Studies, and I'll also be your MC. This evening's performance promises to be filled with excitement and a display of art and intellect. Before we begin the program, on behalf of the board, I'll ask Ms. Morgan to greet you as well. Ms. Morgan?
Thank you. Thank you and welcome. On behalf of the board, I just want to thank you all for coming. We know that you could have chosen to be anywhere else tonight, but you'd made the decision to come out and to support the students of the Rochester City School District as you see them doing something positive. And we just really appreciate your being here. We welcome you and thank you.
Miss Aloma Kaysen will introduce our first performance by the Dr. Freddie Thomas High School Gospel Choir. Miss Kaysen. I think Miss Kaysen is still greeting people. While we're waiting for Ms. Kaysen, we want to thank Freddie Thomas, principal, for coming out this evening and supporting her choir. And we're very excited. Yes, let's give her a hand. I had an opportunity to visit your fabulous school and was very, very impressed. I was impressed with the atmosphere and the climate that existed in the school. I was also impressed with the students that I saw. They were engaged. I was impressed with the hallway that's set up and designed for students to interact in a positive way. And right now we're going to have Ms. Kaysen introduce the choir, and then the next voices you hear will be the choir.
Good afternoon. We are so honored to have the Freddie Thomas High School Gospel Choir here today. It is very accomplished in its own right. And we thank Ms. Jordan, and we thank Ms. Brooks for making it possible for them to be here today. So if you would, please welcome the Dr. Freddie Thomas Gospel Choir. Thank you.
Thank you so much for waiting. We were also waiting on our accompanist to come and play for the choir. He hasn't arrived yet, so I guess I'll play, and you just follow me the best you can, choir.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory. Now, this ain't church, but we can pretend. Let's give the choir another hand. As the choir is taking their seats, Commissioner White just walked in, and so we'll give him an opportunity to greet you all. Commissioner White, let's give him a hand.
All right, now, she said it wasn't church, but you know, you don't have to be under a steeple to have church. So y'all can say amen. Oh, that's not how you do it on Sunday. Say amen. Hallelujah. Yes, indeed. He has helped us overcome, has he not? You know, when you talk about black history, you got to talk about overcoming, right? Now, for black folks, white folks, Latino folks, brown folks, black folks, you all can say amen to that, because he helped us all overcome. Because as a nation, we had a lot to overcome. Not just black people, but white people had a lot to overcome, right? Barack's election is part of American history, and we have overcome as a nation, right? Y'all can say amen to that. Each and every time every one of you graduates, that's us overcoming. Well, each and every time one of you becomes a teacher, a doctor, a lawyer, a garbage man, a technician, a plumber, we have overcome. Isn't that right? Y'all can say amen to that. You don't have to be in a history book to make black history. When you graduate from school, you make black history. When you parent your child, you make black history. Well, come on, mom and dad. You hear? Y'all shouldn't invite me up here, because you know I'm going to preach. You know I'm going to preach. Listen, enjoy this month. Enjoy the fruits of our history. And I'm telling you, the fruits are all around us. They're in our teachers. They're in our principals. They're in our students. They're in our parents. You all are a part of black history. So thank you for participating tonight.
Now, see, I said it wasn't church because I wasn't going to preach. But if I knew the Reverend Deacon Dr. Doug was coming. Thank you, Commissioner White. Our next performance is a Gemini step team from number 46. And this team is made up of fourth, fifth, and sixth grade girls. The team name is Geminis, and their colors are red and black. Vicki Dames is the school secretary and the coach. Now, I have to make a comment about that, because you know what? It's awesome when it doesn't matter what your role is in the school, when you still pour into the children, because each of us has an enormous responsibility. And another quick sidebar, Commissioner White said that we should be celebrating this month. Soon, we will be celebrating this every single day. This won't just be something specific. We are really pushing, and we are making moves so that our children learn about who they are as African descent people, and so that all children understand the contributions of Africans and African Americans. So that was my sidebar. Laquana Coker is the choreographer for the team, and this is her second year having a step team at school number 46. The girls are excited, and we're excited about them as well, and so are their parents. And so let's welcome the Geminis.
Back when in the past ain't with them shoes. Yeah, we divas, but we ride like big boys do. Black titty with a white stripe in a stain. Looking in the mirror at my bad boy fitty up. Show stopping till they lose their breath. Turn the wheel to the right, turn the wheel to the left. We in the car, we ride slow. We doing things that the girls don't do. The boys stare, we smile back. All my girls in the rainbow Cadillacs, yeah. Bet you were never seen, just wearing this clean. We have a ton of seats, we do it deadly. That's how we keep it pumping. Show that bass knocking. So when you see us dropping, we always show stopping. Show stopping, show stopping.
Give it up for the Geminis. I'm gonna step next. At this time, I am going to have the founder of the Frederick Douglass Memorial Art Speech Oratorical Competition come up, and she's gonna give you a brief history of the program, and then we are gonna hear from our first set of orators. So after Dr. Juanita Pitts comes and introduces the program to you, our very first orator after her will be Anthony Aponte. Dr. Pitts.
Good evening. A special greeting to the parents, some who've had to take off early from work, and our illustrious persons of the board. We certainly happy to be here today, and I'm just going to take a moment to let you know that there are some people in Rochester who don't know that we have a Frederick Douglass Memorial Speech Arts Competition. Now, it's taken me too long to say that, but it's been in operation for over 25 years. And we would certainly hope that you would be impressed enough with the young orators who are here today to go out and tell your neighbor, you should have your kid in that program, because they're bound to learn something about their own history. And I tell them they're going to learn a lot about their own history because they live in the same town with Frederick Douglass, or at least where he was. And I believe he's still here, buried in Mount Hope Cemetery. So that they have a lot to be proud of. And to say that I am going to be a spokesperson for the man who was here back in 1899 when they put a statue up downtown just for him. And we certainly applaud those young people who are going to present themselves today to let you know how much they do know as a result of having a great experience over at number 12 school. They've already been to Washington to collect their earnings down there, and I'm certain that that news will be coming to you very shortly. And I can only tell you that I'm just so filled up and so happy. I better sit down because I don't have too much to tell you about the joy we all should feel this day, and to have them represent us as the citizens of Rochester, New York. Thank you. City School District, your church, and we had our beginnings, as you know, in the church, and we haven't left that. So I don't want to preach tonight, but if you want to invite me to your church to tell you that we want the smallest children, as soon as they can talk, to learn a little bit more about themselves and about ourselves. And hopefully we'll be able to generate some interest from this very group, this meeting, and that we'll see some teachers who will say, oh yes, I like little children, and I can get along with a terrible two-year-old, and let the three-year-old teach you a little bit about what he knows about life. So it's going to be an interesting opportunity for us all to write some change. Thank you so much. I
I was taught in my home growing up that you give place to the elders, and when they speak, we listen very quietly. Our next performer is our youngest orator that Dr. Pitts just made reference to, our five-year-old Anthony Aponte, who is from school number 42. Anthony?
I have chosen for my subject That Which Stirs a Nation's Heart by Frederick Douglass. Small pots boil quick. Empty barrels make the most noise when rolled. But that which has the power to stir a nation's heart and shake the foundations of church and state is something more than empty clamor. Only mighty forces resting deep down among the foundations of nature and life can lash the deep and tranquil sea of humanity into a storm the like of which the world is now witnessing. Cold water add to cold water makes no disturbance. Air add to air causes no jar. But when fire is brought in direct contact with water, when truth grapples with loathsome air, when the clear and sweet current of benevolence sets against the bitter stream of selfishness, when mercy and humanity confront cruelty and ignorant brutality, there cannot fail to be agitation and excitement. Thank you for listening. Let's give Anthony another hand. Let's give Anthony's parents a hand. Let's give Anthony's teachers a hand. I have goosebumps. And I'm overwhelmed, and I'm very emotional. But this is a true testament of our historical and our current greatness, and this is why it's so important for us to provide opportunities for our children and to provide them in an authentic way. Look at the skill of the five-year-old. I can imagine our ancestors looking down on us now. I can imagine Frederick Douglass looking down, smiling, knowing that the steps that he laid, the foundation that he built, that we're reverencing that today. Let's give Anthony another hand. Our next orator is young Eric Daniels, and he's a second grader from school number 12. Eric?
My turn came in the late summer of 1824. I was six. Grandma Beth wrapped a newly ironed bandana around her head, stuffed some cornbread in her pocket, and told me that we were going on a journey. My heart sank. I sensed saw leaving my log cabin forever to that thing they called slavery. It was hot and humid as we set off down the dusty and rutted road. When my legs were tired, Bess picked me up and toted me on her shoulder like a sack of wheat. Even though she was 50 years old, she was the strongest woman I knew. As a man, I told her, "Put me down, Bess, I ain't no baby." Shortly after, I was eating my words. I was so scared I clung to her skirt. I knew that a beast was going to jump out of the woods and gobble me up. Everything scared me. The old logs and stumps grew eyes, ears, and sharp teeth. And all the 12 miles we walked, nothing was as scary as the long green. I saw the White House and slave quarters. There are more children than I've ever seen. They were all laughing and young around me, playing all sorts of wild tricks. Grandma introduced me to my brother and sisters and told me to play. I joined behind the house, but I refused to play. I kept my back against the wall like a wild animal at bay. Grandma went to the kitchen to see the cook. Not long after, a child came running and shouting, "Fed, fed, Grandmama gone!" I ran to the kitchen, and lo, she was indeed gone. I burst into tears. It could be consoled. My brother Percy brought me ripe peaches and pears. I threw them on the floor. My grandma left to sign a goodbye kiss. I miss her. Thank you.
Eric Daniels. Our next orator is Justice Lucas. He is also from school number 12 in the fifth grade. Justice.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Justice Lucas, and I am from School 12, and I will be doing a speech by Frederick Douglass called What the Black Man Wants. I came here, as I come always to the meetings in New England, as a listener and not as a speaker. And one of the reasons why I have not been more frequently to the meetings of this society has been because of the disposition on the part of some of my friends to call me out upon the platform. Even when they knew that there was some difference of opinion and a feeling between those who rightfully belong to this platform and myself. And for fear of being misconstrued as desiring to interrupt or disturb the proceedings of these meetings, I have usually kept away and have thus been deprived of that educating influence which I'm always free to confess is of the highest order descending from this platform. I have felt since I have lived out west that in going there I parted from a great deal that was valuable, and I feel that every time I come to these meetings, that I have lost a great deal by making my home west of Boston, west of Massachusetts. For if anywhere in the country there is to be found the highest sense of justice or truest demands from my race, I look for it in the East, I look for it here. The ablest discussion of the whole question of our rights occur here, and to be deprived of the privilege of listening to those discussions is a great deprivation. I do not know from what has been said that there is any difference of opinion as to the duty of abolitionists at the present moment. How can we get up any difference at this point or any point where we are so united, so agreed, I went especially with that word of Mr. Phillips, which is criticism of General Banks and General Banks' policy. You see, General Banks instituted a labor policy in Louisiana that was discriminatory of blacks, claiming that it was to help prepare them to better handle freedom. Wendell Phillips counter by saying, if there is anything patent in the whole history of our 30-year struggle, it is that the Negro no more needs to be prepared for liberty than the white man. I hold that that policy is our chief danger at the present moment, that it practically enslaves the Negro and makes the proclamation of 1863 a mockery and delusion. What is freedom? It is the right to choose one's own employment. Certainly it means that, if it means anything. And when any individual or combination of individuals undertakes to decipher any man when he shall work, where he shall work, at what he shall work, and for what he shall work, he or they practically reduce him to slavery. He is a slave. That I understand General Banks to do, to determine for the so-called freed man when and where and at what and for what and when he shall be punished and by whom punished, it is absolute slavery. Thank you.
That was Justice Lucas. At this time, I'm going to invite Marilyn to come to the microphone to introduce the Wilson Pearls.
Good evening, everyone. All right, these young ladies, some of them used to be mine when I used to do the step stuff, but all right, these young ladies are known for being motivated, dedicated, and sophisticated. They proudly represent their high school, Wilson Commencement Academy. They have won 6 first place trophies in the Rochester Step Off annual competition and won the overall trophy for outstanding academics and community service last year. They have also won numerous first place trophies throughout Monroe County. This team has been going strong since their birth in 1995. Under the direction of Tasha Hill and the coaching of Nikki Cleveland, I introduce to you the Wilson Pearls.
remix.
I love her cause she got her own. She don't need mine, just to leave mine alone. There ain't nothing that's more sexy than the girl that fall but don't need me. Young, independent, yes, you
are. Let's hear it from the Wilson Pearl.
She can't tell from the way that she wants. She don't slow down cause she ain't got time to be complaining. Surely gon' shine.
Give a sister a chance. I've been working all on the Kindle Wii. It's not happening. So I'm just going to introduce Elizabeth Christine Hayes to you. She's a junior at Wilson Magnet High School in the IB program. And the piece that she's going to perform for you tonight is entitled Because I Care About You. Her inspiration for this piece came from a motivational speaker that visited Wilson High School. During his speech, he stated that because he cared about the students, he took time out to make sure that they could be all that they could be. Please welcome Elizabeth Haynes.
Good evening. This piece is called Because I Care About You. Last night, I asked myself a serious question. Last night, I thought about the people who call me inspiration. I thought about the pain the world has brought to me. Those times I nearly lost my sanity. I asked myself, what am I doing? Why am I here? Why do I care about these people? Where am I going with myself and life? When I got up to see my peers, I found my answer. I told them that I care about you. Because I care about you, I tell you the truth so you know the reality of life. Because I care about you, I tell you about my past. I tell you my dark, painful secrets. Why? So you know you're not the only one going through. Because I care about you, I cry at night. Because anger and confusion can block your sight. Because I care about you, I let you make your mistakes so I know that you'll find your way. Because I care about you, I give you my last, so I know that you'll be okay. Because I care about you, I never give up on you, because I know you're better than what people say. I see you pass the zip code. Because I care about you, I make sure you're not alone. This is our fight. Because I care about you, I hold you tight so you know everything's all right. Because I care about you, I care about myself. I grow up and become somebody to let you know you have no excuse. I don't let my parents' mistakes control me. I don't let my anger block me from my greatness. I make sacrifices to get where I need to go. Because I care about you, I'm on top of the world.
Let's hear it for Elizabeth Haynes. That was awesome. Thank you, Elizabeth. We are going to hear from our next three orators. The next one that you'll hear from tonight is Casey Shields, a fifth grader from school number 12. Casey?
Fellow citizens, pardon me and allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I or those I represent to do with your national independence? Are the great principles of political justice and national freedom in your place? Would to God, for both your sakes and ours, that an affirmative answer could be truthfully returned to these questions. Then would my task be light and my burden easy and delightful. For who is there so cold that a nation's sympathy could not warn him? Who so obdurate and dead to the claims of gratitude that would not thankfully acknowledge such priceless benefits? Who so stolid and selfish that would not give his voice to swell the hallelujahs of a nation's jubilee when the chains of servitude have been torn from his limbs? I am not that man. In a case like that, the dumb might eloquently speak, and the lame man leap as in heart. But such is not the state of the case. I see it with a sad sense of disparity between us. I'm not included within the pale of this glorious anniversary. Your high independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us. The blessings in which you this day rejoice are not enjoyed in common. The rich inheritance of justice, liberty, prosperity, and independence bequeathed by your fathers is shared by you, not by me. You may rejoice, I must mourn. This 4th of July is yours, not mine. To drag a man in fetters into the grand illuminated temple of liberty and call upon him to join you in joyous anthems were inhuman mockery and sacrilegious irony. Do you mean, citizens, to mock me by asking me to speak here today? If so, there's a parallel to your conduct. And let me warn you that it is dangerous to copy the example of a nation whose crimes, towering up to heaven, were thrown down by the breath of the Almighty, bearing that nation in irrecoverable ruin. Fellow citizens, above your national, tumultuous joy, I hear the mournful will of millions whose chains, heavy and grievous yesterday, are today rendered more intolerable by the jubilant shouts that reach them. And if I do forget, if I do not remember those bleeding children of sorrow this day, may my right hand forget her cunning, and may my tongue cleave through the roof of my mouth. Thank you.
Casey Shields, awesome. Next up is Danielle Williams. She is also from School 12 and in the sixth grade. Danielle, let's welcome Danielle.
Fellow citizens, pardon me and allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I or those I represent to do with your national independence? Are the great principles of political freedom and of natural justice embodied in that Declaration of Independence extended to us? And am I, therefore, called upon to bring our humble offering to the national altar and to confess the benefits and express devout gratitude for the blessings resulting from your independence to us? Would to God, for both your sakes and ours, that an affirmative answer could be truthfully returned to these questions. Then will my task be light and my burden easy and delightful. For who is there so cold that a nation's sympathy cannot warn him? Who so obdurate and dead to the claims of gratitude that will not thankfully acknowledge such priceless benefits? Who so stolid and selfish that would not give his voice to swell the hallelujahs of a nation's jubilee when the chains of servitude have been torn from his limbs? I am not that man. In a case like that, the dumb might adequately speak and the lame man leap as a hart. But such is not the state of case. I say it with a sad sense of disparity between us. I'm not included within the pale of this glorious anniversary. Your high independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us. The blessings in which you this day rejoice are not enjoyed in common. The rich inheritance of justice, liberty, prosperity, and independence bequeathed by your fathers is shared by you, not by me. The sunlight that has brought life and healing to you has brought stripes and death to me. This 4th of July is yours, not mine. You may rejoice, I must mourn. To drag a man in fetters into the grand immutated temple of liberty and call upon him to join you in joyous anthems were inhumane mockery and sacrilegious irony. Do you mean, citizens, to mock me by asking me to speak here today? If so, there is a parallel to your conduct. And let me warn you that it is dangerous to copy the example of a nation whose crimes towering up to heaven were thrown down by the breath of Almighty, bearing that nation in irrecoverable ruin. Fellow citizens, above your national tumultuous joy, I hear the mournful wails of millions
whose chains, heavy and grievous yesterday, are today rendered more intolerable by the jubilant shouts that reach them. And if I do forget, if I do not remember those bleeding children of sorrow this day, may my right hand forget her cunning, and may my tongue cleave through the roof of my mouth. To forget them, to pass lightly over their wrongs and chime in with the popular theme would be treason, scandalous, and shocking, and would make me a reproach before God and the world. Thank you.
Danielle Williams, thank you. That was awesome. Our last orator is Darius Clinton. He is also from school 12 and in the sixth grade. Darius, please come up.
My name is Darius Clinton, and the name of my speech is What the Black Man Wants. I came here, as I come always to the meetings in New England, as a listener and not as a speaker. And one of the reasons why I have not been more frequently to the meetings of this society has been because of the disposition on the part of some of my friends to call me out upon the platform, even when they knew that there was some difference of opinion and a feeling between those who rightfully belong to this platform and myself. And for fear of being misconstrued as desiring to interrupt or to disturb the proceedings of these meetings, I have usually kept away and have thus been deprived of that educating influence which I am always free to confess is of the highest order descending from this platform. I have felt, since I have lived out west, that in going there, I parted from a great deal that was valuable, and I feel every time that I come to these meetings, that I have parted from a great deal. I do not know from what has been said that there is any difference of opinion as to the duty of abolitionists at the present moment. How can we get up any difference at this point or any point where we are so united, so agreed? I went especially, however, with that word of Mr. Phillips, which is the criticism of General Banks and General Banks' policy. You see, General Banks instituted a labor policy in Louisiana that was discriminatory of blacks, claiming that it was to help prepare them to better handle freedom. Wendell Phillips countered by saying, if there is anything patent in the whole history of our 30 years struggle, it is that the Negro no more needs to be prepared for liberty than the white man. I hold that that policy is our chief danger at the present moment, that it practically enslaves the Negro and makes the proclamation that is the Emancipation Proclamation of 1863 a mockery and delusion. What is freedom? It is the right to choose one's own employment. Certainly, it means that if it means anything. And when any individual or combination of individuals undertakes to decide for any man when he shall work, where he shall work, at what he shall work, and for what he shall work, he or they practically reduce him to slavery. He is a slave. That I understand General Banks to do, to determine for the so-called freed man when, where, and at what, and for how much he shall work, when he shall be punished, and by whom punished. It is absolute slavery. It defeats the beneficent intentions of the government, if it has beneficent intentions, in regards to the freedom of our people. I have had but one idea for the last 3 years to present to the American people. And the phraseology in which I clothe, it is the old abolition phraseology. I am for the immediate, unconditional, universal enfranchisement of the black man in every state of the Union. Without this, his liberty is a mockery. Without this, you might as well almost retain the old name of slavery for his condition. For in fact, if he is not the slave of the individual master, he is the slave of society and holds his liberty as a privilege and not as a right. He is at the mercy of the mob and has no means of protecting himself. It may be objected, however, that this pressing of the Negro's right to suffrage is premature. Let us have slavery abolished, it may be said. Let us have labor organized. And then, in the natural course of events, the right of suffrage will be extended to the Negro. I do not agree with this. The constitution of the human mind is such that if it once disregards the conviction forced upon it by a revelation of truth, it requires exercise of a higher power to produce the same conviction afterwards. The American people are now in tears. The Shenandoah has run blood, the best blood of the North, all around Richmond. The blood of New England of the North has been shed of your sons, your brothers, and your fathers. We feel that in the existence of this rebellion, that judgments, terrible, widespread, far-reaching, overwhelming, are abroad in the land. And we feel that in view of these judgments, just now, a disposition to learn righteousness. This is the hour. Thank you.
Let's give a hand for all of our orators. Our last performance this evening will be by the Dr. Freddie Thomas High School Gospel Choir. As they come, let's welcome them. As they come, I want to ask you to keep your seats when they finish, because we'd like to pay tribute to our orators. So please don't leave. Let's again welcome Dr. Freddie Thomas, Gospel Choir. Let's hear it for the choir. This is just a small part of the talent that exists in the Rochester City School District. And I'm honored to be a part of the school district. I'm honored to be affiliated with the Black History Committee. They've done some great work, and I'm new to the committee this year. And I'm just excited about the great things that we're going to do. Right now, what we'd like to do, I'd like to call President Evans up so that he can help me present the certificates to the student orators. And also, there's a school teacher from 12. He'd like to come up and make some presentations as well. And so we'll do that at this time. And then we'll have our closing remarks from President Evans. Right now, we'd like to give tribute to Justice Lucas, who placed second in the National Frederick Douglass Memorial Speech Arts Oratorical Competition. Did you want to do that? Okay. Yes, why don't you stay up here? Samaj Webb, who placed third in the local competition. Monisha Foster Cotton, she placed third in the local competition. Eric Daniels placed third in the national Frederick Douglass competition. Danielle Williams, who placed third in the national competition. Darius Clinton, who placed first in the national competition. Casey Shields, who placed third in the national competition. Anthony Aponte, who placed third in the local competition. Howard Eagle III, who placed second in the local competition. If there are any coaches in the audience who supported Dr. Pitts in the program, could you please stand so that we could recognize you as well? Any coaches, any parents? Are there any parents? Parents of the children, please stand. We'd like to recognize you as well. And our last presentation is gonna go to a woman who is incredibly, incredibly special. And she's special for many reasons. One, particularly because she was my first grade teacher. And I consider it an honor to still see her doing the great work. And she contributed to my life, and I stand in the place where I stand because I had some awesome teachers. In addition to that, she was instrumental in working with a younger age group, which is actually not a part of the national competition yet, but it's something that we are pushing for because our skills and talent start at birth. So it's not something that has to be nurtured and fostered once they get into middle school or elementary, but it's at the time of conception. And so we would like to honor Dr. Pitts and I, Ms. Thelma Uter. Would you please come up, Ms. Uter? Ms. Uter is the assistant principal at School 42, and she's worked long and hard with Anthony Aponte and with Howard Eagle III. And President Evans is going to give us closing remarks.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. First off, I would just like to say, give another round of applause for all of the talent that we have in the Rochester City School District. You know, just let me, I think Vice President White and I have had the opportunity to attend every single one of the board's Black History Month celebrations, and I'm sure Vice President White shares this with me, that often we open the newspaper and we see all the negative things that our young people are doing. The media needs to be here because they need to be able to capture the positive things that we have going on in this district. And it is up to all of you that are here to go out and tell the stories of the talent, of the mental capacity that these young people possess. We have to tell this story over and over again. Obviously, we do this every year. I always tell folks, they always say, Malik, little kid asked me, Malik, how come Black History Month's only 28 days of the year? I said, it's kind of like your birthday. You know, we celebrate your birthday to highlight your birth, and we celebrate, but we all understand that Black History Month is 365 days a year because it's American history. So it is critical that we continue to take this energy and carry it throughout the rest of the year. We have one more event coming up this coming Thursday right here in this room. We're going to honor some community members. We're going to honor high academic achievers that are African American in the district. So I want to invite you all to that. But one of the things I learned growing up is that you have to give thanks to people who help put things together. All this stuff doesn't happen by accident. I can tell you that the board signs off on this, but it's a committee of folks that put this thing together, and is led by one of our great staff people, Jacqueline Morgan. If you could stand up, Jacqueline Morgan. And I just want to also mention the other committee members who put in a lot of work to make this happen. My parents always said you give folks their flowers when they still can smell them. I don't have flowers here today, but I will have some for you guys on Thursday. Aloma Kaysen, if you're here, if you can wave, thank you. Is Nicole Crocker here? Nicole Crocker's not here, but she's been. Marilyn Hell, is Marilyn here? Thank you. Is Rhonda Kirkland here? I always joke with Rhonda and tell her she's a street. She's been doing such a great job. We got a street named after her, Kirkland Avenue, if any of you guys know, over by Enon. Jacqueline Morgan, who we mentioned. Jonetta Pugh, is she here? Jonetta, is she here? Nyree Strong, who's our great master of ceremonies. Thank you. And then last but not least, Catherine Wilson, is she here? Okay, and let's just give one more round of applause to all of our committee folks. And lastly, give one more round of applause to the matriarch in our community, Dr. Juanita Pitts. We need to stand on our feet for that. Young people, if you talk about living history, living history here, an example in the community that all of us should talk to and learn from, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you all for coming out tonight, and I hope to see you back here on Thursday. Thank you. Thank you.